I'm going to talk about the complexity of modern war, modern fighting, and how we manage to grapple with these situations from three different aspects. Perhaps a fourth brief one. First of all, the complexity of a strategic achievement. In the context of Israel, Israel is not fighting in Gaza or in Lebanon because it fancies it. If something happens, then it needs to be stopped, as it happened in the Gaza Strip. The actual barrage of rockets started, and it needed to be stopped, or concrete specific threats like the tunnel one had no response, and therefore, in other words, various threats that are critical, they did not make Israel to actually preempt, to give a preemptive attack or preemptive blow. For example, if something happens in Lebanon, I ostensibly think that Israel will not actually initiate it, but it will react to it and it will need to thwart it. And therefore, we have to know, we have to understand this strategic issue. We're not there in order to achieve something. We need to thwart, we need to curb certain things that are happening. So we need to know what the objective is, and the objective will always will have two aspects involved. First one is to ensure that if the tranquility, if the lull has been violated, then we need to ensure that it'll be a long-term lull and quiet that will be returned. And whatever the campaign that does take place or whatever happens, that it should be as short as possible with as little collateral damage and to people and to other things as well, and that they should achieve what they set out to achieve. In other words, that the lull, the quiet, should be achieved. And if we're talking about the various commanders and the soldiers in the field, they have to grapple with various targets sort of, or various goals, and the idea is to curb and thwart. So if they have to do it, either on the ground for ground forces and also by fire, and unfortunately fire can't do it by itself, and we that lesson was learned once again in the Gaza Strip. And I think that the ground maneuvers have a very important role. I think in Gaza, if you were following what was happening, every time the maneuvers, the ground maneuvers, came into the field, then immediately there was a kind of lull because the other side were very involved in trying to sort of cope with that, and therefore they stopped firing as much. So the main issue is that Israel is trying to defend itself against a specific incident. That is the main issue. And I think that how are we supposed to actually, if there should be any future potential conflict in Lebanon or anywhere else, the question is how can we actually react to these things and what do we need to do? But in order to achieve this, we need to work in an area that is saturated in population. It's densely populated. That most of it, the majority, the lion's share of this population, just wants to live their life in peace, and they're not involved. And I think that in the army, over the years, there was a very long learning process, and that was how does one evacuate the civilian population from such an area. Of course, no one is exhilarated by that idea because the population, the civilian population, is part of their doctrine. The Hamas, for example, in the last event in Gaza, continued actually shooting despite all the damage and all the collateral damage and the damage and the harm that was caused to the civilians. It didn't seem to bother them at all. And I'd like to continue and expand on that point because one of the thoughts and one of the assessments that we do here at the INSS is that a kind of doctrine is developing of Hamas. And I sincerely hope that we're not going to have to actually come across that in Lebanon as well. But that is the victim victim doctrine. And this victim doctrine that we call is, it's not that they're willing to suffer, what they're saying is, hey, we want you to fight us while we are in the midst of civilian population. And that's exactly what they're doing. They shoot from within them. They did it in the Second Lebanon War. They did it throughout all the campaigns in the Gaza Strip and also in Protective Edge as well. In other words, that doctrine is a very problematic thing that we have to grapple with, and we're just going to have to learn to contend with this situation. And one of the ways that we are trying to learn and grapple this situation is evacuation of civilian population, but they're not always willing to be evacuated. Sometimes they're not allowed to, they're not permitted to, sometimes they want to look after their property, and sometimes they cannot, they're not able to. But there's also a critical mass of population that we want to remove from there so that we'll be able to actually counter attack people that are attacking us. We're not going in there for the fun of it. We are being shot at, our civilians and our property is being damaged, and therefore they're being hurt, and therefore we are trying to actually stop that. Over the years, Israel has been saying that we will act against very specific targets, and I'm going to talk about that. And we, unfortunately, in the presence of population, because if that target has enough value embedded in it, then we will have to do so, even if the population is there. But we will ask them, we will create axes and routes and arteries for them to be exited through, but we are going to try and real-time evacuate them. And in Lebanon, I mean, it's better that, for example, if something should happen in Lebanon, then there's no reason why the civilians already should know in advance what their exit axes are. And that's something that they should be informed about and how to evacuate them. Because the moment there is a crucial mass of the population that has been evacuated, then there will be a ground maneuver and a very severe attack against them once that population has been evacuated. Our aim is to try and prevent any casualties, any civilian casualties, because we don't want them there in that field when we are trying to actually strike back at someone who is attacking us. And another issue is proportionality and legitimacy. We seem to mix between these various terms, because Amos mentioned here that had there been attacks in the last week of the fighting, then they would have, that I think the way they attacked during the last week, had they attacked like that during the first week, then I believe it would have been a lot better and there would have been a lot of less civilian actual casualties. Because if the target is legitimate in the first week, then of course it's legitimate in the third week. The legality, sorry, he's changed what he said. It's not the legitimacy, but the legality of it. And so the issue is that we seem to be mixing the terms, and I think that we pollute the legal discussion with these issues, because legitimacy is something political, and that is something very sort of fluid. And what is not legitimate now, might be forgotten, your legitimacy in 6 months' time. That's something sort of a bit fluid. So I think that one shouldn't confuse between legality and legitimacy, and it's a very erroneous mixture between, and sort of an admixture between the two. So what we should say is, if it is legal to attack a specific target in the first week and in the third week, then why don't we do it in the first week? And that's a very critical factor, because the faster we do it, then we're going to be saving casualties, we're saving lives. So, I mean, we've been experienced in that. We don't need to learn that learning curve once again. And just a last word about the issue of using artillery fire. This came up during Protective Edge, and it is a topic that is very worrying, very concerning. I'm talking about the statistic one and not the precise fire. Precise fire actually does hit what exactly you want to hit at, but sometimes you don't have enough intel, and that's part of the fighting, and you don't know. Sometimes the targets don't don't have an actual window signature on them, but you know that someone is shooting from there, but you can't always find, it's an impossible to find the intel, because you can't always snipe at that specific person and hit that one specific person. Therefore, precise fire, according to those parameters of just a few meters, is something really crucial. It is something crucial that we have to understand. The second tool that we use is fire in order to rescue, and that is extremely important. A commander who feels that he is in danger, good morning, Tal. A commander that shows that he is in a state of danger, he and his force can and will be able to use that fire in for the sake of rescuing his forces. But hopefully they will be able to understand that kind of operational situation well enough. We have to teach our commanders that so that they won't use that fire in every single little niche and every little nook and cranny and situation. We will have to teach them how to appreciate and assess that kind of use of fire. Is it a rescue situation, life and death kind of situation or not? I sincerely hope that we manage to converge with the timetable.